Hi everyone, good morning and thank you for joining us. I'm Keely Linton with Strong Hearted Native Women's Coalition and I'm happy that you are all here. We have a great presentation today. Just a quick housekeeping. We do have questions and the chat box working. You will not everyone will be able to see your questions in chat, but we will do our best to cut and paste or do whatever we can to make those visible for everyone. So please feel free. We are recording this session. So just note at the end of the session, we will unmute everyone so that you can ask questions directly or you can continue to use the questions and chat box. We will at the end, we will stop the recording and allow you to ask some questions without being recorded. Just to provide a little bit more confidentiality for you. If that's something that you would like to do, hang around with us. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce Mike Duncan. He's an enrolled member with the Round Valley Indian Tribe. His tribal heritage is Maidu, Wailaki, Wintu, and Western Banshoshone. In 2012, Mike Duncan found Native Dads Network and is currently the CEO of the 501c3 nonprofit. In 2009, Mike has facilitated the Fatherhood Motherhood is Sacred curriculum, which with great success and has helped create a network for Fatherhood Motherhood groups in Northern California. Also in this time, he has worked in urban and rural tribal communities, conducting workshops, discussing topics like the Fatherhood Motherhood is Sacred, historical trauma, cultural competency, and healthy relationships. He has used these topics and personal stories to help participants look at barriers and to encourage traditional teachings as solutions. Thank you for joining us today, Mike, and I will turn it over to you.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Friday. I'm excited today. I mean, it was one of the things I woke up this morning, or even last night, I was thinking about this presentation. I got kind of excited, you know. I think one of the things that, I guess this journey of wellness that I've been walking, I've been understanding more in what's, I guess my role in the community. And so there's a movement called Fatherhood is Sacred, by Al Pooley, and which I'm part of. I'm a facilitator, also a trainer for NAFA. I'm also, like I said, I'm also the CEO for Native Dads Network. Which is a men's program, but we've opened it up to mothers and also to families. So we're doing a youth component and also a motherhood component, and we're doing wellness workshops and things all through Northern California. And so it's pretty amazing to watch. And one of the exciting things, I guess, for us again, is that, we're just continuing to grow and grow in this idea of wellness and trying to heal our people. And so it's been a long journey. I've been doing this since 2009. And to say that out loud, it's like, man, it's been 11 years, on this journey. And one of the things that, that always comes up, in a conversation or in when doing this work is, the violence against women. And it's hard, it's something that, I guess, as you grow, it's like I've learned a lot in the last 11 years. And some of the things we'll talk about today, I identified with at one time, when we talk about abuse or narcissists or even gaslighting, you start to go, man, that was me at one time, and you start to go, well, shoot. Well, if I could heal, if I understand this now, if I could be educated about it now, I have a responsibility to change. I have children, and I want to teach them as a father, I want to teach them the most positive way to conduct themselves, both, physically and mentally, emotionally and spiritually. And so part of that is understanding what we've been taught, understanding like some of the things that are not traditional, because of going to the topic like domestic violence is not traditional. So we'll get some of the things that are traditional and understanding some things that aren't traditional. And it takes work, because a lot of times the hardest thing to do is look at ourselves and say, well, what can I do? How am I participating in that? Am I? Do I? And sometimes it's our own children. It's our own. It's our uncles. It's our fathers. And we go, wow, that is so unhealthy to say out loud, you know. So we know people that are unhealthy. We know people that, you know, that maybe are abusive, and we don't say anything, I think. And so part of that is, again, it's a, I think it's a responsibility. And I'll get more on this later on about the responsibility of everybody to kind of look at what healthy communication is, healthy relationships are for the betterment of our future generations. You know, and it's hard because, like I said, no one really wants to look at themselves and say, hey, you know what? I can be abusive at sometimes. And I say mine openly because I have a different point of view today. I don't look at things the way that I did 10 years ago, 20 years ago, even 5 years ago. I've continued to work on myself and seen things in myself and that I wanted to change. And I think that I know things that are healthy, things that I'm preaching, that I'm on to practice what I preach. And now I'm kind of going, now hopefully that inspires other people to go, you know what? I need to look at myself too, as a man, you know, and even as a woman. There's other women that are abusive too. Seen it, worked with them, and it's real, you know. And but not to take away from the high percentage of what perpetrators or people committing the crimes are men. The majority of the men are being abusive. And I have daughters, you know. I have 5 children, you know, ranging from 24 to now my youngest is 13, but I have 2 daughters. And you know, it's important. I think I put a message out to out in the community, or be part of the solution in the community for their safety. You know, I have nieces, I have great nieces, and you know, I want them to have safe partners. And so, you know, ending the violence against women is important to me, you know. And part of that is, as a man, you know, we got to be humble. We don't have to. I guess one of the things the responsibilities are is not a new word that I've learned about mansplaining to women what's best for them. And that's misogyny. You know, I did a workshop, a global one, not too long ago on YouTube, the pick called the Pixel Project, and the lady was out of Beijing, I believe, and we talked about misogyny. And you know, and those things are just things. Like I said, it was a normal conversation with 3 men. They were all from the United States, but some of the messages that were coming in from I guess the audience that was listening or watching was there. Man, there were some hateful men out there. And so those things, you know, you look at and you go, man, we have, even though with some of the progress we've done with all the, I guess we read my bio, you know, I worked with a lot of different communities, worked with a lot of different men groups. I realize when I see that kind of a response to men standing up for women, men recognizing their shortcomings and character defects, that we, and I realize that we as men have a long way to go to heal, you know. And you know, this is why these are things are so important, and I'm honored to be here today to share. Like, I was here Wednesday, and if you join in Wednesday, I'm gonna do a whole different kind of script than I did once. I kind of just shot it off the hip and just went off whatever was going on in my mind, and it went well. I thought it went well. But we're going to do something a little different. I'm gonna give a PowerPoint. And like I said, there are some things, and you know, this PowerPoint was actually designed when we were doing it, was to, I think one of the things that helped me in my recovery or in my healing is education. And what I mean by education is that like, if you don't know, like, I love how as Don Coyes talks about this, if you don't know what you don't know, how do you know, right? And so as I started to recover, I have 13 years of being clean and sober, and I'm walking that red road, you know, as and through my healing, you know, you start to, like I said, I thought clean and sober was like the end of my wellness journey. Like, as long as I'm clean and sober, that's all that matters. And then you start to look at your emotions, you start to look at your strengths, your weaknesses, and you start to look at what can I improve on just in life, you know, not aiming for perfection, just looking, like I said, looking at our shortcomings and our weaknesses, and our really are faults and things that were like belief systems. I started really looking into those things. And so those things were important for me to change. And education was, so when I sit down, like I said earlier, when I sit down and get to chance to just read something, and I'm just, and it don't have to be nothing long. Like I said, reading about being a narcissist or being a gaslighting, small little, and maybe some of the signs, I go, man, you know, I identify with that. I've done that. I've done that. And those are things are, you know, humbling. You go, you sit back and you go, man, here I am. You know, I want to be a leader. I want to be somebody that stands out in front and says, this is the work I've done and kind of the proof in the pudding. And but you have to be honest with yourself. You know, you have to be honest with the work that you do. And so this is where I go in when I come into men. You know, this PowerPoint is really was aimed to use going, hey, we had roles traditionally, but I'm gonna enlighten you a little bit, just a little bit about who we are, and how it all ended. Because again, you have to remember, like in our communities, and I'll get a little more in this, but just in our communities, I know for a lot of people, they only see what they see today, or maybe the last few generations that our men have become abusive, in all levels, sexual abuse, violence. You know, women are now have more cases, and when they come to my office about women coming to anger management or physical abuse, and that's maybe by a reflection of them defending themselves. Who knows? But the violence is kind of escalating, and so what we're trying to do, and hopefully these platforms help us get to a better understanding of why we do what we need to do, why we need partnerships, why we need to be sent the message out. Like, violence is not traditional on any level. We need to teach our younger generation the same exact thing, and the best way to teach this is through example, right? We need, our language and our thinking needs to match the things that we say, and so it's an important time, you know what I mean? Especially with all the chaos going on in the world, is that when we start to look at, you know, inside our own communities and our progress, this is part of it, you know, as progressing as people and getting well, healthy, sober, you know, and not having just domestic violence or violence on any level. And also, you know, the missing of murdered Indigenous women and young boys that is happening inside our communities. We need to put our foot down and say no more. We need to do something about it. And so we'll get into our, and if you have any questions, please just shoot them on out. I'll try to answer it. All right, so I'm going to a PowerPoint. I'm also going to show a video. Like I said, this video of PowerPoint was aimed for men when I first started doing it. But everybody's more than welcome to use it or have it. There's a lot of this information. It came out of the Addressing Family Violence and Abuse out of a NAFA curriculum written by Al Pooley. And so there's some of my stuff, but most of this is his stuff. And so, but I facilitate this class. I've been facilitating this class for the last 4 years. I've been doing the Fatherhood is Sacred, Motherhood is Sacred since 2009. I've been in a healthy relationship since 2012. So I've been working on, you know, all this for a very long time, trying to, and it's interesting because this has never been my goal to kind of get this kind of platform. It was like just doing classes here in Sacramento, and it's kind of took off from there. And I've been on all over the states. I'm presenting on violence against women, violence against men, fatherhood, you know, motherhood, and historical trauma and intergenerational trauma and things like that. So welcome everybody, and I hope you, like I said, if you have any questions or if you want this PowerPoint, you're more than welcome to have it. And I'll just start off doing this. All right. So I'm told you can see my face in the corner here. So, all right. So addressing family violence and abuse. My tribal heritage, Konkau, Maidu, and Wailakin, and Wintu. On my father's side, and then Western Band, Shoshone, Timok, out of Nevada, on my mother's side. I'm also the executive director of Native Dads Network, established in 2012, and we've been in facilitating classes mostly in Northern California. Now we've made some, did some things, two things we did, we've been, and also probably I should add this to my bio, we've done, we've been doing Boys with Braids That's something that's been working and very, I guess, popular in a lot of communities because of the teasing and the bullying our youth are enduring, boys with braids. And I know that's a different, I guess, presentation, but I just want to throw that out there because we've been working with Michael Linklater out of Canada. He's the founder of it, and he's an awesome dude. And if you don't know who he is, man, find his bio. Go to Facebook, go to Instagram, man. Dude's amazing, man. A young man, man. I think he's in the middle 30s, man. Just a professional basketball player, athlete, travels the world. He's retired now as far as basketball. He played on the international team. But he's just a great presenter and has a good heart, man. Workout machine. That dude's a beast. So, oh, shoot. Sorry, y'all. So this is just something that, I've been using for the past years. And it's just something that inspires me. And what it really basically says, in a nutshell, you know what I mean? It says we are the ancestors of our grandchildren's children. We look after them just as our ancestors looked after us. We aren't here just for ourselves. We are here for each other and for our children's, our grandchildren, our children of our grandchildren. And I think it's important just to understand that, we're laying the foundation, just like the people that came before us. The people that came before us, they had a vision, they had dreamers, they had people that were praying for us. And all they wanted is for our people to thrive. They wanted our people to be healthy. My role today, this is, we're just continuing that prayer. That's the way I look at it. We're continuing the prayer. We're continuing to say that we want healthiness and goodness, and we want thriving for our future generations. But I, like everybody, and that's why I shared this last night as well, is that we all are responsible for the future. Every person is responsible for the future. What we say and what we do is so important. How we think is so important. And we have to change our thinking, and we have to base it on goodness. That's just the bottom line. You know what I mean? The hate, the violence, the lateral oppression, lateral violence is, we can't exist no more, right? And if we're involved with those things, gossip even, it's like, if we're involved with those things, then and we have to be like courageous and say this can't happen anymore. Now, sometimes I feel like because there's so much of it in our Indian communities, we feel like our voices are just drowned out by the hate and anger and violence. But we have to take that first step. There has to be that continuous consistency. People need to hear the consistency. And I just use my own life for example. Like this fatherhood thing, like I said, it was never something I've really planned. I never planned to speak up for violence against women. I never planned, like, really, was just only I was using it for a better to better me. I was like, let me go to this program, start a fatherhood program, and I was hired by an organization, and I said, sure, this could help me, and just by me speaking out, and I remember really trying to get on my own when the Native Dads Network was first starting. I was out going, man, I'm doing a fatherhood program. I go to tribes, I would go to the clinics, I would go to the casinos and put my hand out, say, hey, can you donate? And they're like, ah, man, we maybe get $1,000, maybe get $500 here and there, but we were penniless, man. And now, we've grown to, we have bigger grants, and man, we're getting larger donations, and because they've seen the work that I've done. But it starts somewhere. And so somebody asked me on Wednesday, said, I wish we could have this here. What can we do to start something in our community? And I guess my answer to that would be, again, just take that first step and be very consistent, at the opening of the doors. It takes a lot of what we're trying to build, and this is what we've been doing in our community. And whoever you have in charge, like whoever you're in charge of your men's group, women's group, youth group, make sure they are kind, nice, and sincere. Nobody will go to a jerk. They'll push people away. They'll make people not want to go to it. You know what I mean? Just don't hire somebody because it's your cousin, or it's your uncle. Make sure they're good people. Make sure they come from the heart, and they want the best for the people. You know what I mean? And they're willing to take some of the punishment because, to be honest, it's hard work, and I don't always get rose petals thrown at me. You know what I mean? Sometimes they'll throw those thorns too, and those hurt, you know. But I know what my purpose is, and this is the, you know, Creator's already talked to me and gave me permission and gave me the courage to continue walking in. So it just takes that prayer. So it's really, I mean, I don't know if I knew this earlier, but I can't really read my screen. Am I back on? Sorry, y'all.
Yeah, you're good. We can see it.
Oh, you see it?
Yeah.
The problem is I can't see it.
Okay.
I can't see it. So I think, hold on, let me do this. Dang it. I'm gonna, okay, yeah, I just. Can you still see me?
Yeah, I can still see you and your screen.
Okay, perfect. So addressing family violence and abuse workshops promotes the safety and welfare of family members. Abuse and violence are the behaviors to intend to attempt to maintain power and control over another. This oppression is cruel and unjust treatment to exercise authority over another. Oppression involves inappropriate and unfair. Sorry, y'all, it's my dog. An accident and this forced process of submission to authority to bring someone under control. The power of abuse lies in the submission. I always find that very, you know, when I read that, it touches me every time because I think one of the things is, and we'll, like I said, a bit more, I don't want to get jumped again because I have a tendency of doing that, but we still have to understand where the violence or why people do what they do. When abuse and violence happen between family members, it greatly impacts the entire family and the future generations. And that's why I lead out with that beginning statement. I mean? The impact, you know what I mean? It's like the selfishness sometimes of the abuser. It's really just like it becomes about that person. And we talk about we'll talk about narcissistic behavior later on, but it impacts the whole family. You know what I mean? The children are feeling the trauma and the pain as well. But before we get into that, I would like to we look at those things and you know, I really want to start off like this is what I do a lot of my presentations. I like to start with natural order, and because for a lot of us, we can only see the present or maybe what our parents showed us, you know, and those are that's a real because we the way we think is because of our experiences, right? That's what our belief system is based on, of our experiences. So a lot of times when I talk to community members or people involved with violence in their life, trauma, sexual abuse, anything, when I'm like all their thoughts are based. So when I tell them, hey, you know what? You're worthy, or you're a good person, you don't deserve this, because their experiences have shown them they're not worthy, or their trauma showed them that they're worthless, or they don't feel like they have anything to offer or anything like that. That's where their thinking lies, and that's what their belief system lies at. So it's a really hard job to shift that belief system, right? And so what I tell people is that, you know, a lot of our trauma, we talk about intergenerational trauma, is that, you know, it's a genetic memory. We know that the trauma is transferred through our DNA. And a lot of us, and I don't know if everybody believes that, but I believe that. And I would go into a longer story, but because I have something that's relevant to all that right now. But I don't know, we got an hour or so. But if we look at that, we believe that, then we also have to believe that, you know, our ancestors before pre-contact, before there was white people here, before there was houses here, before there was colonization and everything else, and boarding schools and everything, you know, our people thrived. You know, our people were good people. Or people they probably experienced some things, but they had solutions to things. And so I know for a fact, you know, and like you got, you know, but no matter what tribe you're from, that you come from good people. And so that is also passed through our DNA. We have to believe that. If we believe one, then we have to believe the other. Either the bad came or the trauma came, then we have to believe the goodness also came. And so getting to that and saying, well, let's look at the natural order of things. And like this morning I was, because this is I was using this as like an all day presentation. So there was a lot of slides in this, talking points, but I kind of cut it down. So I looked at roles of men. When we look at the roles of men, you know what I mean? We had, like I said, we were purpose. There was purpose, right? There was really, like, let me put it this way. In our villages, in our communities, the reason why we thrive for thousands of years is simple. We thrive because we had a belief system of rules, protocol. There were things that were required to be an elder. You just weren't considered an elder. Like today, like we give it an age, and then we say that person's an elder. That concept wasn't looked at then. Obviously, it was looked at. It was protocol. Whatever that your tribe was, whatever village you were. Same thing as adults. You know, there is rules to being a man. There is a warrior or a woman. You know, and they had different. Things they had to learn growing up. They still had things to learn, you know, to become that warrior. And they wanted to become that man, looked at as a man in their community, whatever that role was. Not everybody was a dancer, or not everybody was a medicine man. Not everybody was a hunter. You know, there people had different roles, and they found their purpose. And then whatever those were, they stick to those rules of whatever that purpose was, whatever the contributes. And same thing for the women. And we'll get a little bit of women in a second. Even as youth, there was coming of age ceremonies, puberty ceremonies. There were things that women and the adults in their lives that told them how to behave, what the responsibilities were when they started becoming a man. And it's something they looked forward to becoming part of that, right? And so even as children, there were rules. Like a lot of time the children played. that was the rule for them, that you be young, you be a child. Because they knew at one point, at some point, those days would be over. It's time to grow up. It's time you have different responsibilities. So here we talk about the roles of men, right? And say there's just something that, you know, again, a few things: leaders, fathers, husbands, sons, brothers, uncles, grandfathers, healers, ring and makers, teachers, protectors, tool makers, basket weavers. I mean, we go on and on. This is just a brief, you know, like a description. But also, then in word, when you look at teachers, we talk about kindness, teachers of emotions, teacher of, you know, again, we talk about, and it says healers, it says we understand the importance of healers. We understand the importance of like healing, because if we dreamt something, like these are how these songs and ceremonies came about. It was for our healing. And so these are important things to understand. Like we're still, these still things are still within inside us. You know, people have a tendency to believe the lie before they believe the truth. You know? Same things with the women. And so when I work with women, they've been through domestic violence or just healing through recovery, you know, I tell them the same exact things. Yeah, thank you. And they had roles. And they're the same things. You look at them, teachers, and like I said, there's some things that is a longer list, but you know, some things I just cut out just to make it, because I knew I'd bring it up anyways. You know, there are medicine women, there are nurture protectors, you know, teachers, you know, there are leaders. You know, we come from matriarchal societies here in Northern California. The women had a role to lead our people as well. They had input, and the men carried those things out. But again, natural order of things. It's the way we look at ourselves, right? What our belief systems are. But then a time came, you know, and there's a time when genocide came, colonization came, and removed those things. And this is just a reminder, because this is important, that when I do this, especially with men, said you, like when I started looking at myself, you know, I started feeling this guilt and shame about some of the things that I've done in the past. But I only was mirroring, I don't know if that's the word mirroring, I guess it probably it is, now I said it right, I think, mirroring the things that I was taught. Or better yet, I was only doing things I wasn't taught. No, that makes sense. But I wasn't taught certain things. And when I understand that now more, I don't say it relieves me of, but it eases some of the guilt. Because like I said earlier, if I don't know what I don't know, then how am I supposed to change it, fix it, right? So now that I know, and this is why the education is so important, is understanding people, like this is, again, this was taken from us. Now, probably preaching to the choir, but it's just a reminder saying that, you know, we were eliminated, and this is systematically done, how to eliminate our manhood or the men. Because when we talk about single parent homes and women raising children on their own, which is a beautiful thing, you know, I'm not downing it. But we need men need to raise men. We need the man in the home, right? And I'll even say it's something even more in depth, is that we need healthy men raising healthy children, right? And so, but it stopped somewhere, and now we know where it stopped at. We have proof, we have documentation that was written by the colonizers when these things were implemented, right? And so we talk about historical trauma, we talk about all the things that came with it, and the top of that list is talking about domestic violence. And again, these are things that we know. Right, these are things that we just know that exist in every Indian community that I've been to. Urban set, communities of Indian people. All these things exist, you know. And it's a lot. It's a lot to attack. One parent homes, self-hatred, depression, feeling hopelessness, loss of culture and spiritual identity. And I like this one, abnormal becomes normal. We start to believe the negativity becomes normal. Those are the lies that we start to believe, like it will always be this way, right? Like the crab is in a bucket, you know what I mean? Oh, like Indians always trying to pull each other down, which is true at some point, you know. I experienced it myself. But doesn't mean I have to be that way. So I try to change that. It's not my normal. No parenting skills. Dependency on the government, on the system, and then repeating the cycle. You know, that's what we talk about, the intergenerational passing of all these different topics. And I mean, honestly, I could go through each one of these, and we could talk about it. Those are all talking points. These are all talking points. So if you decide to use this PowerPoint or parts of this PowerPoint into maybe in a group of yours, if you're running a men's group, or you want to start a young boys group, and these are the things that we're trying to change in our community. These are good topics, talking points, because they're all exist in our communities. Then you say, well, what can we do to change these things? Give me examples. You know what I mean? And we'll get to the positive, the positiveness there, but the solutions here in a minute. So what is domestic violence? Again, domestic violence is the intentional violence or abuse of any family member to oppose power and control or harm to another. So I have a video. I think this is where I show the video. Yes, video. So bear with me here. Hopefully, everybody see that? Everybody good?
Yeah. Yep, we can see that. It's good.
Awesome. All right, here we go. It's about 6 minutes.
The stories of American Indians and Alaska Natives are as varied and nuanced as the people themselves. But the latest study from the National Institute of Justice finds one troubling through line that links these stories: the experience of high rates of violence. Like songs and oral histories, science can raise awareness by quantifying the severity of violence. It's time to hear what the numbers are saying. The vast majority of American Indian and Alaska Native women and men have experienced violence in their lifetime, and 1 in 3 have experienced recent violence in the past year. Those levels are higher than the general population, but that's not where the inequalities end. The study also measures a range of impacts as well as services needed because of violence. What's behind those numbers? Let's start with the finding that for American Indians and Alaska Natives, violence doesn't discriminate by gender. Women and men share similar rates of victimization. That means almost 3 million American Indian and Alaska Native women and men have been victims of violence. To put that number in perspective, imagine if everyone in the state of Iowa stood up, or every resident of Orlando, Dallas, Detroit, Anchorage, and Atlanta combined. That's the scale of the violence. But what about the scope? The NIJ study breaks types of violence into 4 categories, and violence against American Indians and Alaska Natives is high across all of them. Take stalking, for example. It can be a gateway to more aggressive violence, and repeated, unwanted, fear-inducing experiences come in many forms. Lifetime estimates of stalking for women in the study are almost double those of non-Hispanic whites. Add male and female victims together, and that's more than 1.2 million people. That would fill 20 sports stadiums if every single ticket holder had been stalked. Being forced or coerced to engage in unwanted sexual activity is another form of violence, a form all too familiar to American Indians and Alaska Natives. For example, these mothers, daughters, and sisters face almost 2 times the risk of sexual violence with penetration as non-Hispanic white women. Overall rates of physical violence by intimate partners in the past or present are even higher, from being shoved to having a gun or knife used on them. More than 1 in every 2 women and more than 1 in every 3 men have experienced physical violence by intimate partners in their lifetimes, comparatively much higher than the physical victimization rates over the lifetimes of non-Hispanic whites. Of course, not all violence is sexual or physical, so the NIJ study also examines psychological aggression. For example, expressions of anger that seem dangerous or humiliating, or controlling access to birth control. Overall, psychological aggression affects more than 1 in every 2 women and men. Psychological aggression may not be as obvious as broken bones or bruises, but it is real. Among victims, 63% of women report partners tracking them, and 55% of women report being kept from family or friends. These are just a few findings, but remember, they are numbers that correspond to real victims who would feel the entire state of Iowa. Now picture if 97% of women and 90% of men in Iowa were victimized by people of other races and ethnicities, interracial perpetrators who violated the safety of their schools, workplaces, parks, homes, and bedrooms. Numbers alone don't tell the whole story, but they do point to a dangerous gap. Most federally recognized tribes don't have the legal authority to criminally prosecute non-Indians, even for crimes committed on tribal lands. So, what does it all mean? The impacts of high rates of violence against American Indians and Alaska Natives range from missed days of work or school to physical injuries. It's not surprising that services are needed, like medical care to treat injuries. But here's where the NIJ results uncover another glaring disparity. Almost 40% of female victims who need services can't get them, compared with only 15% of non-Hispanic white female victims who fall through the cracks. American Indians and Alaska Natives deserve better, and now there is science to prove it. These numbers are not abstract. They bear witness to real people, mothers, girlfriends, brothers, and grandfathers. Our hope is that this study will lead to a story of a new beginning, one where all of us listen to what the science is saying, what the victims are saying, and unite to prevent violence wherever it happens.
Yeah, right. So, let me go back here. Oh, shoot, how do I get back on there?
Your PowerPoint's up, Mike.
Yeah.
Am I?
Yeah.
Can you take this off? How do I do that?
Just go to slideshow on the top. You want to continue your PowerPoint? If you go to the tab that says slideshow, at the top it says home, insert, design, traditional, animation, go to slideshow.
Oh, show screen. Which one?
Slideshow at the top. Let's keep going at where it's the home along those tabs. There's a slideshow a little over to the right.
That one?
No. Now go to the right where your tab, your mouse is.
To the right.
Yeah. And then slideshow.
I don't know. I can't find it. How come I can't find it? Over here?
A little bit further, at, just at the top there, where it says, this is transition, animation, slideshow. There you go. And then you can play from current slide. All the way to the left. Is this from current slide? Yeah. And then you can start it. Yeah. There you go. It's up.
All right, so this is, again, just some of the recap of some of the things they were saying. I'm going to skip over that because we just had to watch that video. Domestic violence, you know, I just want to briefly go over this. And again, I how much time do I have? Where are we at in time?
You have about 40 minutes.
40 minutes total? Yeah. Holy, hey, there's a lot of talking. Okay. All right, so domestic violence, you know, there's like I said, there's different components, physical, verbal, emotional, spiritual. I'm just going to go through some, and I think one of the things that's important, and again, it's really, like I said, when you're working with men, or if you're working with, you know, I'll say just working with men mostly, or an abuser. Oh, geez. I'm on. Sorry, y'all, my dog came to attack me. Well, there's four components that I'm going to mention. Is, again, it's just identifying some things. And I think, like I said, it is about education. Sometimes people don't really realize, you know, how many times that I've gone to communities and worked with people, and they don't even realize that they're abusers, you know. And so, like I said, I'm not giving people a way out. But I think a lot of times, you know, in relationships, people they'll be in a domestic situation, and neither partner will leave. I've seen it time and time again. And I'll tell them again, because sometimes it gets to the place where some of the information will tell me, I'm like, well, if you guys are gonna stay together, then you gotta work on some things. And And so, like I said, some of the things I use, again, is just giving them information so they understand where they're at as in the relationship. And so some of the things we identify is, like, you know, of course, physical abuse is a physical force against another person that causes injury, damage, and endangerment. Abusers can be male or female. That includes hitting, choking, shoving, showing anger, losing temper, throwing things, making threats through physical force, injuring others such as children or pets. Whether intentional or unintentional, those things are something to really look at. And sometimes, as far as when we start, sometimes we don't really look at that as it's not us, they're doing to our pet or doing something, they're breaking things inside our home. You know, those are still, that's still physical abuse. You know what I mean? Slamming down the TV or throwing your cell phone or physical abuse. Verbal abuse is an attempt to control another individual through words. Verbal abuse is insults, threats, harassment, belittlement, name calling, making fun of others, shaming out, or bullying, or negatively bringing up someone's past. Learning to control our words and the things we say can be one of the greatest challenges in life. How you communicate reflects, I like this part, I should bold this. How you communicate reflects how you think and feel about your family or about the person, your spouse or your partner. How someone talks to you is what they really think about you. I think, and I remember that was when I heard that, I was like, wow, that was very impactful to me. You know, how someone talks to me is what they think about me. And that really changed my perception of what verbal abuse was, because I didn't think that was verbal abuse. Because again, you get raised up, you're maybe grown up by your parents or you know, people around you, and they talk to you negatively, or you just kind of go think that's just normal way of talking. Remember I said the abnormal becomes normal, that put down or shame people out or constant criticism, you start to get used to it and you think that's just normal. That's how people are supposed to. And it really does, it attacks your self-worth, which we'll get into in a minute. Emotional abuse is often the most difficult to identify because there is no visual evidence of bruises, cuts, and scars. In reality, however, emotional abuse has a deeper, longer lasting to the victim. And this goes on to bullying, jealousy, fault finding, and that's huge. When a person can never find anything positive in you, they just, all they do is fault find. They'll tell you consistently what's wrong with you. They'll ignore your feelings. Undermining self-confidence, constant criticizing, manipulating with lies and half-truths. And half-truths are huge, because a person won't believe a full lie, but they'll believe a half-truth. Half-truths are lies. It's connected to emotional abuse. Applying the silent treatment. Oh, what's another one with manipulating lies and half-truths? Manipulation also, again, and lies is also staying silent. You won't say anything at all, because you know, because you already know the answer. You know, the person knows if they find out, you know, the other person will be mad. So they just don't say anything at all as part of a part of a lie as well. Applying the silent treatment, refusing to communicate. Those are also emotional abuse. Always blaming others for personal behavior. That's those signs of narcissists. And also put down the name calling. Again, these are just things, again, it's just, you start to look at these things, you go, man, you know, those are signs of abuser. Gaslighting. Gaslighting is a form of emotional abuse that is seen in abusive relationships. It's the manipulating of a person by forcing them to question their thoughts, memories, and the occurring around them. A victim of gaslighting can be pushed so far as they're questioning their sanity. Now, as a person going, man, you're crazy. What are you thinking? You know, you keep on asking me, well, are you crazy or something? They keep on using terms like that. And when they start to do those things, you know, that's what the term gaslighting comes from. No longer feeling like the person you used to be. You feel different about yourself. Being more anxious and less confident than you used to be. Often wondering if you're being too sensitive. Right? Feeling like everything you do is wrong. Always thinking it's your fault when things go wrong. Apologizing often. Having a sense that something's wrong, but being unable to identify what it is. Often questioning whether your response to your partner is appropriate. And that's a huge one, right? That's a huge one. Wondering you were too unreasonable or not loving enough. Start to blame yourself, right? Making an excuse for your partner's behavior. Avoiding giving information to friends or family members to avoid confrontation about the partner. Feeling isolated from friends and family. Finding it increasingly hard to make decisions. Start to question your own better judgment. I should add that too. Feeling hopeless and taking little or no pleasure in activity you use to enjoy. So again, you know, those are the behaviors of the victim or survivor of a person that's gaslighting them in abusive relationships. And so it's just information, you know, as you're doing workshops or if you're working with the community or if you're, this is you in general, you have to ask yourself, you know, this is good information for us to kind of go, well, I need change in my life. I need to look at these things. These are happening to me. What can I do to change those behaviors? And so I'm going to just briefly go. I'm not going to read. Like I said, if you want this PowerPoint, I have no problem sharing it with you. Joy will email this out to everybody. But it's just some of the, like I said, it's a recap. If you already know this information, great. But sometimes I think what I've learned through the years is that I'm just not going to assume people know. A lot of times I'll share some stuff and I'll go through it real quickly. And then at the end, somebody will go, can you re-explain that? And I'm like, and so I'm thinking that everybody knows this information. And so if it's something that you already know, this is a good refresher. But if it's something you don't know, good, read over this. Like I said, educate yourself. If it's somebody you know, give them this information so they know what it looks like. Like I said, it's really about planting seeds. You know what I mean? I think working with enough men or abusers in general, I've learned that it doesn't, just because I tell them this information, it doesn't work. It takes a minute for it to process, for them to get the aha moments. But we have to continue to work with them. We got to get our men healthy, or the person healthy. So we just have to continue giving them the information that they need to so they can work on themselves and see what they can do for themselves to make themselves better. And we'll get, like I said, in the other part the healing part, we'll get into some of that. Extreme jealousy. Jealousy is the signs of insecurity and lack of trust or self-worth, you know. But the abuser will say it's a sign of love. And it's funny because it's not funny, but it's funny sometimes, you know, you go in Indian country and people say, oh, that's Indian love, jealousy. And they'll make a joke of it. And I used to kind of laugh and we all kind of laugh about it. But in reality, it's not funny. In reality, it's scary. Well, that was what we believe. And people believe that's how we show love, is to be jealous. It's scary because it leads into other things. It leads into harm, it leads into somebody killing somebody else, because sometimes when it gets out of control, that's where it leads to death. You know what I mean? Controlling behavior. A person that is always checking where the person's at. Where are you at? What are you doing? How come you're doing that? Who are you with? You know, that kind of behavior. It's not okay, you know. So those, again, those are red flags. Sometimes, and this is quick involvement. You know, I see something like a little meme the other day. Somebody posted on Facebook and said, how do you know we're together? He's like, hey, I move in with the first 2 weeks. but that's also a red flag of an abuser. You know, they want to come in really quick into control. They want to, like I said, be part of your life. They want to pressure you into loving them. You know what I mean? It's part of an abuse. unrealistic expectations. You know? Meaning like their partner has to be the person, like they're expecting you to be perfect. That's not even realistic. That's not even, I always tell people, especially like, if you expect me to be perfect, you better be perfect yourself, right? It's unrealistic to think somebody's perfect because we're not perfect. That's what makes us human beings, being imperfect. Isolation. The abuser tries to keep the victim from friends, family, by putting everyone down. How many times have I heard that, you know, in communities? Like every time you bring up a family member, they want to talk, shoot them down, talk mess. You want to talk about your friends. Oh, they're just this, they're just that. And they try to keep you away from them because of that. And it goes back into like emotional or psychological abuse. Blames others. Signs of a narcissist, right? The abuser does not take responsibility for their problems. They blame everybody else. And so I think when we look at victims or survivors, you know, these are good keys to warning signs, red flags, healthy relationships. People, I mean, one thing that we teach encourage adding financial manipulation. Good point. I just read that on the side. Financial, and I think we'll get to that in a sec, maybe. If not, I will definitely add that. That's a good one. Financial abuse. Hypersensitivity. The abuser is easily insulted and takes everything as a personal attack and blows things out of proportion. Right. So how many people do we know like that? I mean, hypersensitive. Yeah. And only I think it really hits me because I used to be that way, where a person would he disrespected me or he don't respect me. And those things, you know, like I said, when I really start to, I guess, dissect my life, or we start to look at my, like, look inward when I do some of these presentations, you go, man, that can't apply to me, right? Verbal abuse. The abuser says cruel and harmful things to the victim or survivor, degrades them, curses at them, calls them, puts them down. Again, we talked about that a few minutes ago. Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, severe mood swings. And that has, I think that we talk about mental health, stigmas of mental health. This really goes to like bipolar. One minute they're very angry, and next minute they want to, you know, make love or have sex. You know, it's like, it says one minute they can be charming and sweet, next minute they can be very angry and explosive. That's a whole conversation within the side of self. But again, it's something that when you're working with the community, that's something to think about and to bring up. Use of violence and threats of violence. And last can help, it can include holding the victim down, restraining them from leaving the room, or pushing or holding them against the wall. And so a lot of times men will do that and think that I'm not an abuser. I didn't hit you. You know, I just grabbed you and held you in place. No, that's still abuse. Or you say violent words like, you know, if you leave, I'll kill you. Or I'll break everything in your home. Like those things are like common. You know what I mean? It's very common. And we don't think those things, we think those are just moments of rage or maybe isolated moments. No, those are red flags of abuse. You know what I mean? And so, again, these are just, again, a few things that I jotted down to kind of just, again, get to that place of understanding this, of what violence is. So now we're getting close to us restoring things, the balance. I think the important thing, and the reason I put the slide up is that, you know, or left the slide on, is that to get to this place, and just to understand, really truly understand the difference between order and chaos, and to get out of the chaos and bring order to your life, is really looking at ourselves and because it comes to a place and say, we are responsible for our happiness. Each one of us, you know, whether, you know, we look at intergenerational, people have been harmed. Like, and somebody mentioned here on one of the chats, it says, hurt people, hurt people. And I believe that, you know, there comes a place where, you know, as a man, you know, I mean, again, like I said earlier, though, there was, before I, you know, when I started getting educated about an abuser was when I started getting healthy and recovered of alcohol and drugs, then I started realizing, man, a lot of these abusive traits, man, existed in me. And so I work on myself so I don't have to, you know, I don't want to be that. I don't want to be that person. I don't want to teach that to my children. I don't want to show them what that thing, those are. You know, it starts at home first, starts with me first. Before I go out and teach anything. And this is where I think my experience is different from some people, because I'm not, you know, I'm not proud of those behaviors, but I have to be honest and show not only my children, but show the community that I'm in, live in, that people and men can change if they want to. Not to say every man has to be vocal and say, that's what I did and I want to change, but hopefully I inspire men to say, okay, well, I look at themselves, I could do it. It's okay to look at myself and change, you know. And with that, it becomes, you have to look at, there's importance of rules in your life. There's importance of bringing traditional values, traditional principles back into our lives. So we always have to be willing to look at solutions, right? And here, and it was on the bottom bullet, it says, life is a journey of learning how to solve problems. Most often we are, when we are in a state of chaos, and if we're not looking at solving problems, we start becoming the problem, right? And so I really wanted to be part of the solution, you know, looking at my my past and using that as a platform, my experience to use as part of the solution for other community members, other men, Native men that maybe experience similar internal stuff that people can heal if you want to change. There are men out here trying to do what you're trying to do. So let's restore and balance. All right. How you doing, Rain? I see your name popped up. So here we go, again, towards the end of our solutions. And I think, man, it gets really heavy, you know, if you have any medicine and you wanna, or maybe I triggered something and I wasn't meant for that. You know, I've also learned through my doing this is that, you know, I've sat with, I've done addressing family violence abuse workshop, attended for men, it set it on the fire, and 90% of the room would be women. Yeah. And speaking, I know that, you know, speaking about past violence or speaking about violence, women spoke openly about this triggering them to being angry and fear and other things that I don't, that's not my intention, you know, when I do these workshops. We're all healing, and that's the important part, I think, for me to share, is that we're all healing, and there's going to be some uncomfortable, awkward moments. There's going to be some triggers. And so if these things are triggering you, you know, I offer prayers and I suggest that you find somebody in maybe in your community, or maybe the smudge, or you got medicine near you, smudge, maybe pray, sing a song, you know, find, go to the clinic, you know, maybe ask somebody, a therapist or somebody in your community for the help, you know, because these are really hard topics to talk about. And I know this, you know what I mean? And again, it's something that, you know, I'm aware of now, you know, that by healing hurts people sometimes when hearing the topics that we're talking about. And so I just want to be sensitive to that, and that I'm supportive of the women movement, the violence against women movement. And I know my role in that. It's not that I'm trying to be the leader of that. I know women are in charge of that movement, and I'm just a supporter. And I'm doing my part by trying to reach out to men and trying to share healing and trying to share education to them so they can look at themselves to become better human beings, better men, better fathers, better husbands, better boyfriends, better sons, and so forth. So one of the things that we start off with this part is really going to, we really got to get back to the place of prayer. And these are our prayers. I believe that, you know, this is not by accident, that this is, again, something that's been prayed way long time ago before I was born, you know, that I'm just doing creator's work, that this is that's be a place of goodness, and that that, you know, when I make interaction with men or even women or community members or even this on this platform, as far as, you know, doing webinars, I realize that this is what creator is asking me to do, and he's asking me to share my story, share my life, my experiences. Not to be ashamed, not to be scared, to just have faith in him that I'm supposed to be doing this and to make impacts on other people's lives. And so a lot of times the fear is, again, that that's the destroyer or the devil or whatever you decide, a dark spirit sometimes telling you not to do things because he's putting that fear into your spirit, you know. And so it's important to us, you know, when we hear good things or we're kind to ourselves, and we're positive and we trust in the creator, that our spirit will be fed. You know what I mean? There's our faith. It brings back hope. It brings back all the good things that we need to build ourselves back up. And so that's where we start. That's our foundation. And Al Pilley talks about it. This, like I said, this is out of Al. No, this part ain't, but as far as using creator as our foundation is what he consistently talks about. And whoever you pray to, and I'm a firm believer in this, is what I believe. That I don't have, you can call creator whatever you want, God, Jesus, whatever you decide to call that spirit, you call it, you just do what you need to do to use for your spirituality. That's not for me to, or anybody to tell you how to pray, you know. So you just do what you need to do to feed your spirit goodness. So if we're going to do this, is what we must base it on truth. And Apollo talks about being lovers of truth. And this is, again, this, we're going to simplify this. It says it's not really about, erase a lot of things. Just look about our self-worth and how you think about yourself. Some people believe that this is who I am. I'm always going to be this person. And I challenge older people, like, this is who I am. And I always go, no, that's who you're choosing to be. You know, when we talk about being a well elder, a welder, as my relative Dean Hogan talks about, you know, and when they're in the communities and they attend my workshops, they're teaching me something. They're teaching me that you're never too old to learn, and that we should never be stuck into one way of thinking, right? We always are learning. And what we always learn is that, you know, if we're basing it on like our experiences, this is who I am, this is where we're cheating ourselves. When I hear something good, no matter where I hear it at, you know, that I know that I could use it, no matter who it comes from. You know, when I hear that ceremony, or when I hear that from somebody that believes in the Bible, or somebody from another race, if they speak truth, I understand it. And if I want to add that to my life, I will use it. You know, so I'm always learning. You know what I mean? And so we must believe that we're worthy. We must believe that we're good people. So to get to that place, we must honor our past to improve our future. You know, using our past, you know, our tradition. Like I said, traditional violence is not traditional. Let's use our traditions, right? Let's use something that our men used prior to the past, you know, of what we've experienced through colonization and assimilation and the horrific things that boarding schools have taught us. Let's look past that. This is before that. Let's use those traditions. I mean, that's who we are, right? We got to be forward looking, forward thinking. And this is important because our future is depending on us to be looking forward. We can't dwell on the past. We can't use that to hold us back. We have to go, you know, maybe I've been through some traumatic experience, but my kids don't. That's my stuff. I don't have to give those teachings to them. I'll give you an example. No, I'm not gonna share that one. It'll take a long time for me to show, but the example, I guess, I'll just shorten it down, is that, you know, whatever negative things we're experiencing in life, we don't have to pass it forward. We have a choice to give good things going forward. You know what I mean? Whatever negative things happen to me in life, is that this is my stuff. Yeah. I don't have to teach that to my children. I'm aware of what negative things are. I'm very aware of what they are. The choice is that let those things, when I die, let those things die with me. The good experiences, the good things I want to pass forward to my children. And that's what I hear, or what I read forward, looking forward, thinking. Those are the things that I want to pass forward. I always have to remind ourselves about in the process of solving problems. You know what I mean? And that when I stop solving problems, I become the problem. This is about always, this is traditional thinking. You know what I mean? You think when when our people had hard winters, you think they said, oh, forget it. I guess we're not eating this winter. We're just going to die. No. You think when something had bad, or somebody got killed in our community, you think they said, oh, well, he's dead. It hurts there. Just let him deal with it. No. They were the dreamers. They were the people that came and said, what do we do to make sure that our people feel good about themselves? How do we make sure our people eat? What do we need to do? They were always solving problems. They always, in the hurt that they felt, they were always going, well, this is what we need to do when this person's hurting. We need to have ceremony. We have healing songs, we have healing ceremonies. Whether it's a Nipi, roundhouse, whatever, wherever you come from, there is, they drip things for our healing. Well, today there's nothing different. There's nothing different about today. We have to stay in the solution. Right? And so we have the instructions. The instructions are, is returning things back to the natural order. Right? The natural order. We know through traditional teachings what those are. Right? And the conflict is society today, right? What society teaches us, what they teach us on TV, what they teach us in music, what they teach us in, I mean, let the list go on. You know, they teach us, we start to believe, we start to watch movies and we start to believe what they're showing us, you know what I mean? And it's not reality, you know? And so it's really getting back to the beginning, right? And all of us have to make a choice whether to be an asset to our family and community or be the burden. Now, when I heard that years back, when I first started doing this program, I was like, crap, because I know what burden was, you know, and I, you know, something we brought up in one of my groups the other day. It's like, talks about integrity. It's like when we go to, we could be nice to all the strangers out there in the world, right? We could go to work and be nice to our coworkers, tolerable, patient with them, even though they're stressing us out. We could show patience with them. And then we get home and then we're irritated. We're not patient no more. We're not tolerant anymore with our family, our wives, our husbands. You know, we're impatient. And even though we're patient all day with people, we get home and we're the opposite with the people we say we love. And so I challenge people to look at, you need to be the asset. You need to be the person that brings happiness in the home and the goodness in your home, and the kindness in your home, and the safety to your home. You know, this is our work that we need to do as community members. You know what I mean? As family members, you know, what do we bring inside our home? You know what I mean? Are we bringing all that ugliness and mess inside our home? A lot of times, yes. And then when our home should be a place of safety, a place of happiness, place of goodness. You know, it's something that we have to teach more, get more into, making that common thought process, common belief system. You know what I mean? This is our safety place from all the ugliness that's out there. the importance of self-worth. And this, you know, like I said, I mean, I'm not sure how much time we got, but I'm going to just go on this. And I think I'll have a couple more slides after this and then we'll get done. Like, I go all day, but I know people have things to do. The importance of self-worth. Each individual, each person has to understand their worth. You know, and I don't think it's emphasized enough in our communities. I don't think it's emphasized enough in our homes. Each person has value, right? When I see somebody broken, whether it's man or woman or child, when they're broken sitting there and I start talking with them, their value, what they think about themselves, what they allow to happen to them, is their struggle, is their experiences, is their belief systems. It becomes, they think about themselves as deserving of the negativity that's happening to them. And what we try to build upon, and what I try to build with men and women, and even youth, when a lot of youth, I've been seeing a lot of youth lately, what I try to build with them is the idea of, it doesn't really matter. Don't let other people tell you who you are. You have to believe you're worth you're worth this much. You're worth a lot. And personal experience would say that, you know, I remember I was doing this work, and like I said, I'll share personal information because I believe that's how people relate it to themselves, is that I remember getting an argument with one of my kids' mothers, and she said, "You have everybody fooled. They think you're this great guy, and you're not. You are who you always been." And I was like a jab right to the chest. And I was like, whoa, that was mean. But it had me thinking for a second. And what it made me feel like at the time was like, is she right? Here I am, you know, I try to practice the best of my ability. Is she, you know, really resonated with me. And what I found out about that was that if I change, and this is like, that's what her feelings towards me was. And I can't change this. I have to accept the way she feels about me. But if I don't believe who I am, then who will? Right? And what it made me do was it made me work on myself and say, I got to be consistent at this all the time. When I interact with people, friends, when I interact with community members, when I act with my children, it's not an on and off switch. When I even interact with her, and our relationship's okay. It's not that that was a while back, but it made me look at myself and say, okay, well, this is something that I need to do. And our relationship is good now, you know, as far as understanding, you know, that I need to be a certain way 24 hours a day. And it's about my worth. How do I see myself? How I interact with myself? It's not so much how other people look at me, but how I work with myself. And the consistency of me thinking that way on a daily basis has brought me hope. Has brought me to a place of understanding of saying my purpose of what we're trying to say when I share this with people is like, you have to believe this 24 hours that you are valuable. You not only need to think that way, you need to talk that way, and you need to behave that way with everybody and everything. Right? And we start to believe that. And when people see that in you, the way they view you changes. It's just the way it works, right? Now, there are choices, and there's a belief system in this, and then that's what I believe. You could choose to be that way, which I encourage people to do that when I'm working with people, or you could believe what you always believed. Not worth anything. You don't deserve anything. Those are your two choices. And when people start to realize that I do have a choice in this, that I am worthy, I am worth, then maybe this person's treating me in this way, or maybe I'm treating myself, and change starts to happen slowly. And that's the beginning of it all. And it's our responsibility to continue to feed that worthiness, that hope, that goodness to them. So this brings visions. And so this, again, this is action, you know. It's about us envisioning ourselves in a better place, a better relationship, better human beings, a better spiritual place. That look at ourselves as self-worth, you know. And again, it's something you guys could go over. Because I will go to this, I guess it it brings it helps develop self-control and positive attitudes. I love that one. So 10 keys to being a successful relationship. I'll just go over the real thing. Like I said, this PowerPoint was sent to you. So you'll be able to use some of these things. And so I'll just read them off real fast. Is if you want a successful relationship, it says be available, listen to understand, create safety and acceptance, keep promises, do not judge or blame, do not criticize, keep things confidential. That means keep it off Facebook, keep it off social media, all your business, forgive, have respect, gratitude and appreciation, and set a good example. Be the person you want in that relationship. Be the person you want in that relationship. Now, again, you see, again, there's nothing in there. Say if you want a successful relationship, be abusive, be controlling, be name calling. You don't see those things in there. These are so good. If any relationship, even with your children, this is a good starting point of understanding how to have a successful relationship. I know this is my last slide, and so here's my information. If you want more information, get this PowerPoint, or I do presentations, workshops, and things like that. So here's my information for that. If you're interested in any more information, I said information three times. So I think I'm done. I think I'm tired, but I think I'm over. So I'll click out of this, and I'll hopefully go back to my screen here.
Thank you, Mike. We appreciate your insight and your teaching. I celebrate you and your work. You do a great job on helping our families. Do we want to open up for questions? Does anyone have any questions? I don't see anything in the chat box, but I will unmute everybody if anyone wants to ask a question.
Yeah, wait, hold on.
Everybody should be unmuted.
I'm trying to look for how to get my. I want to see you. How do I do that?
Oh, you can't see the screen. I can see you. You're there.
Okay. All right. Well, this don't matter.
I have a question.
Oh,
go ahead.
Oh, my name is Coco. I'm over in Bishop, Big Pine area, and so appreciate this presentation. Truly useful. I'm working as a MAT nurse and just dealing with trauma all the time, trauma everywhere. And part of what I'm thinking is, you know, when it comes to the anger and abusiveness, sometimes I think that there may also have been brain trauma, aside from just emotional trauma and maybe some other physical abuse. But it occurs to me that we can't always rule out that someone hasn't had a brain injury. And concussion, football accident, whatever it is, it could have been physical abuse. And so that's something that I feel like I should share. That was kicked out, just sort of broken open in this conversation. But what I wanted to ask is if you could talk just a minute about spiritual abuse. I think that's actually a really significant issue that we need to think about more.
First, I'll say if you're from Bishop, I say money who. yeah, I have. I've been to Bishop a few times. I was going there for a while, working with the clinic over there. I meet a lot of awesome people. They're working on themselves. So, beautiful place. The beautiful country. I love that place. Spiritual abuse. You know, there's two things. And I think one of the things when I guess what I'll start with what the definition is as far as them saying, I guess what the common definition is. Again, I guess it's holding people back from praying to maybe making fun of them when they do pray, or how they pray, who they pray to. That's the form of spiritual abuse. That's what they talk about. I think I take it to a deeper level for myself when I talk about spiritual abuse. And I will say, for me, it's when somebody, when the emotional and mental abuse occur, when you break somebody's spirit. And when you break somebody's spirit, you know, they become weak. They become really vulnerable. They don't think they matter. They're lost. They're confused. When you break somebody's spirit, they don't have any motivation. They're defeated, right? So when spiritual abuse, and so when we look at and so this is something I'm glad you brought that up, because again, I should, maybe that's probably one of the slides I know I have that slide in there, and I must have deleted it on accident. But with spiritual abuse, and then when you're building something, and when I'm working with people, that goes when we're talking about self-worth, is really, what are you feeding your spirit? Our people knew this a long time ago. People know this now. When you talk to captains or spiritual leaders, you know, or water pourers, or you know, something of that nature, they'll talk about feeding your spirit. And so I always ask people, what are you doing to feed your spirit? You know, today we have a lot of different techniques to do that, right? Ceremony obviously is one. You go into ceremony and you ask Creator to build your spirit back up. Because we don't, like you said, we don't talk about this enough. You know, when I get, my spirit is feel low, I'm able to identify the times when my spirit feels like it's not being fed or feeling a certain way. You know, like I said, I'll burn medicine. I'll sing some songs to myself. I'll be sitting there on my couch, or I'll be laying in bed, and I'll just, or wherever I'm at. Sometimes I'll be sitting in my car. I'll just turn everything off. I'll sit in silence, or I'll go to the water and I'll make an offering, and I'll wash up and I'll just wash my face, you know, reconnect with the land, reconnect with certain things. I just look around and pay attention to all the things that are moving, that are existing and still circulating. And they're just moving. That's what we would say, natural order. Everything's just moving naturally still, you know, and that'll help me, my spirit, in that way. Sometimes it's about reading books, because we're, you know, that's just how we learn today. And or listen to videos of people with inspiring words. You know what I mean? So at least like daily meditations, or we read things that go up, this is my spirit. It makes me feel good. Makes me feel positive. You know what I mean? So there's always this, there's so many different ways that we could use, or we, like I said, certain songs on the radio. It don't have to be native songs. It could be just something that's, Christian based or church based. Songs just uplift us, like, man, I don't know. Like I said, I don't do those things, but I'm just saying, giving examples of things that can uplift your spirit. Make sense?
Absolutely. Right? Thank you so much.
Okay. Oh, Cushion Dean, he says, great job. Thanks, Kanim. Kanim Mitch. In all my presentations, I always mention Dean Hoagland's name at least one time when I say welder.
Does anyone else have any questions? I don't see any in the chat or questions.
I talked their ear off. That's probably why they're ready to go have lunch.
Well, let me stop the recording in case anyone has a question. I guess. Did it stop?